Well, hi, everyone. Welcome to the MIT Press Live. I'm Nicholas DiSabatino. I'm the Global Publicity Manager here at the MIT Press, and I'll be hosting today's talk. I'm very excited for y'all to meet today's guests. Saul Griffith is the author of Electrify, an Optimist Playbook for our Clean Energy Future, which was published last month. Saul is a MacArthur Genius Grant recipient, a graduate of MIT, and the founder of Rewiring America. Bill McKibben said in his review of the book, "I don't think anyone else has quite so credibly laid out a realistic plan for swift action in the face of an existential crisis." And Nature, in its review, said, "The book demands attention." We're also joined today by Shuzhong Zhang and Sam Kalish. Shuzhong is a principal research scientist at the Laboratory of Molecular Architecture at the MIT Media Lab. And Sam is an engineer and scientist developing technologies aimed at the electrification and decarbonization of our economy. He is the founder of Elmworks and Folly Research and is head of research at Rewiring America. Gentlemen, thank you all so much for joining us today.
Great to be here.
We're really excited for you all to be here. So today we're going to have these three gentlemen talk with us a little bit about Saul's new book, Electrify. I'm going to let you guys kind of take it away, and then we're going to have time for Q&A about 15 minutes and 20 minutes before the end of our talk today. I'll be popping back up. So I'm going to let you guys take it away. Thank you all so much for joining us today. We hope you enjoy.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you, Shuguang. Thank you, Sam. So I had a little bit of say in who could be here for this event. And firstly, I'll introduce Sam. Sam actually helped significantly in writing the book and in preparing a bunch of the data and the charts. Sam and I've also been spending a lot of time in the last 18 months working on energy policy and translating the ideas in the book into policy in various places, including in the US, in Australia, and in Europe. And when the MIT Press asked us to put together a panel for MIT Press, they said, "Who would you like from MIT?" And Sam and I almost unanimously and instantly said Shuguang Zhang would be our favorite professor. Not that you have any favorites, we love all professors equally. But Shuguang is a dear friend from my days at the Media Lab, and he's a broad and international thinker on all issues. His specialty is actually biology, but I think it's his big picture thinking was why it was an obvious choice to have Shuguang interview us, and then we forced him to read the book. Hopefully you did that, Shuguang. He had a copy with a lot of notes, so I think Shuguang, now you've got shown us that you have so many questions and notes, it's over to you. Although maybe just, yeah, the last words, I will say, really happy to have MIT Press be the publisher. I think the imprint carries a lot of weight and is very rigorous, and that was important to me. But the book really was written for a general audience. Very specifically, we were trying to write a book that would influence public policy and be a North Star for people looking to organize realistic on the ground climate action. So although the book is about energy, really the subtext is how do you transform our energy system to meet the demands of our climate crisis?
And I'll just jump in and add to the list of accolades of Shuguang's. He's an incredible mentor to more scientists than I can count, including both Saul and myself. So thanks, Shuguang. And then to MIT Press, it's really an honor to have worked on a book for a publisher that also published Bicycling Science, one of my favorite books ever. So it's been a pleasure.
Well, thank you, Saul and Sam. It has been a great pleasure to working with you and Saul for more than 20 years ago, and Sam for last 10 years. And the book, I wish the book should have come out in September or October, will be delivered to every single one at the COP26 meeting. Unfortunately, it was a little too late. But it's still not too late for the people to read this. I think this is one of the best book written for energy policy ever, because Saul, the chapter he wrote, one of the most important, the change of the thinking, is that 1970s thinking, which should be 2020s thinking, 21st century thinking. That is conceptual change. That is emphasized over and over, not the efficiency, but the new innovation way to electrify the system. And the other one I really like, so you did is compare the war effort. The war effort. And US did it in the 1940s.
Let's unpack that 1970s idea for listeners. So, because I think it's interesting, and then I'd love to talk about the war effort as a follow-up. But the first energy crisis that happened in the US happened in 1973, the oil crisis, just after the publishing of Silent Spring and the first Earth Day in 1970. So there was a burgeoning environmental movement. Nixon was in charge. The oil crisis happened. At that point, there was no Department of Energy, and so, in fact, Nixon set up and set the wheels rolling to establish the Energy Information Administration and the Department of Energy, and their first tasks was find out how to fix this oil energy crisis that we have, and it was a supply crisis. So 15% of America's energy was missing because it had been cut off from Arab oil. And that was why there were people, you know, lined up behind gas stations. And when they did the study and the analysis for how would America get out of that problem, they really thought, well, if we're short 15% of our energy, let's just make everything 15% more efficient. This literally got translated into public policy in the time subsequently and became what we know as the corporate average fuel economy standards, CAFE fuel standards, and Energy Star appliance standards. And everyone's probably seen those little CAFE badges on the window when you're buying a car, if you're buying a new car, or on appliances at the appliance store, because efficiency was considered the way you solved the 1970s energy crisis. You just make everything 15% more efficient and that missing energy goes away. Obviously, you can't efficiency your way to zero emissions. And so the 20th century crisis is a transformation crisis, yet we're still trying to use the tools and the thinking from the 70s. The transformation version is you transform the energy system by electrifying everything, and then it turns out that if you sort of, and the book is based on a huge amount of data, if you run through all of the energy flows in the US and you think about how you electrify them, so you substitute electric vehicles for internal combustion vehicles, that lowers the amount of energy for all that driving by about two-thirds. If you use electric heat pumps driven by wind and solar as a substitute for the heating systems that are currently natural gas or heating oil, you lower energy use by another two-thirds. So it even turns out, once you think of this transformative thinking, so how do we get to zero emissions but still have a vibrant economy and everything we want? You do it with electrification. But the side effect of electrification actually is the efficiency we were always looking for. It reduces the total amount of energy the US needs by a little more than half. Anything you want to add anything on that, Sam?
Yeah, I mean, just I was dumbfounded when we kind of worked through the data on that one half bit, and that comes from not looking just at the supply side like the 1970s energy crisis did, but also looking at the complete picture of how energy flows from the supply to the demand and all the things required to get it there, like mining and refining fossil fuels end up taking a massive amount of energy, as does transporting just the sheer mass of all the fossil fuels we move through our economy. And so in addition to things like the thermoelectric losses that Saul's talking about, there are just a whole host of these other things that we kind of just think of as the cost of doing business, but when we electrify and transform, they go away. And so that's how you get up to over a half.
Yeah, it's interesting. We're talking to an MIT audience, so we can get a bit nerdy. It's we really did look at every single energy flow in the US. So nearly 0.75% of US energy flow is using natural gas to pump natural gas through 1 million miles of pipelines to maintain pressure. Nearly 3% of US energy is using oil to turn oil into petroleum and distillate in refineries. And about 0.25%, so nearly half of freight rail in the US is coal. And so 0.25% of US energy is using diesel to pull freight trains towing coal from where it's mined to where it's burnt. And all of those energy uses in the supply chain for fossil fuels actually consume upwards of 8% of US energy flow. And that should proportionally go down when we switch to electrification with renewables.
In Japan, Europe, and now China, most of trains are running on electricity. And China was running coal until probably 1990s. And then once decide to change in electricity, then did it in last 20 years. So it's a political will. Somebody have to really want to do it. And China has no lobbyist. But here, they follow lobbyists. That's what the solution's done. That's very, so your book is so well written and about the major subject. And
So Sam and I have been living the experience that you just talk about. In last year, I founded an organization called Rewiring America, and Sam and I have been using that vehicle to try and affect energy policy in the US. And it's a nonprofit, and we volunteer a lot of our time. And it turns out that if we weren't in DC fighting the fight for electrification and lowering carbon, we would be overpowered. I mean, we already are overpowered. I think when we, it feels to us like we're outspent 100-1 by the natural gas lobbyists on the Hill. But, you know, Sam actually was fighting them this morning, literally. And it's you've got to be in every Senate hearing where these things come up, and you've got to have the data and to back you up, because there are very cynical lobbyists trying to slow down this transition all the time in the US.
Definitely. And just adding to that point, I mean, you're right, Shugong, it is political will, but it's also following the economics. Like, these, not only are we reducing energy, but we're reducing costs, both costs for, you know, on the generation side, but also costs to American households for heating their homes. Modern heat pumps are amazing. And so the, you know, the bills that they produce are even better than natural gas in most places in the US today. And especially in the face of this coming winter, when we're expecting elevated energy prices and high winter heating bills, heat pumps are considerably less volatile than these end uses that are tied to a spot price, which will always vary a lot. And so these are safe ways to lock in energy bills for folks. And so just getting that message across, it is political will, but hammering the economics is really important here in terms of, like, growing the tent and getting people on board.
So I also say, you did a calculation, how much it will cost. It's essentially, it's about one US GDP, 22-24 trillion. And that is cheap compared to save the planet. Otherwise, by 2050, and Boston, MIT included, be inundated with water. New York, Miami, London, Amsterdam, and so on, Stockholm, Shanghai. Those costs will be hundreds of thousand trillion dollars.
It's amazing to me that these people still don't believe that the water is going to rise, I think. So the cost, yeah, I compared it to that cost because we were actually looking at the analogy to World War II. So it actually, quote unquote, cost America one GDP. There was a thing called the Wartime Production Board, and they actually produced that graph. And the Wartime Production Board managed the largely volunteer private public partnership between US industry and the American government to manufacture all of the war materials to win World War II. So for America to decarbonize, it will cost about the effort that it cost to win World War II. But what's underappreciated about that is World War II transformed the American workplace. We bought African Americans into the workplace in huge numbers, and women in huge numbers for the first time. And then that became a permanent change to the American manufacturing force. and workforce. And because America built up so much capacity for manufacturing during World War II, they profited enormously in the decades afterwards. So the American dream that we all remember was sort of built on the back of that wartime production capacity, which made the 1950s and the 1960s this huge booming economy for the US, as it was actually, it still had production and it was building all of these goodies, not just for America, but for the whole world to climb out of World War II. It would be the same. So I actually think that it's dangerous that world governments keep coming out and saying how much it would cost to solve climate change, as opposed to how much it will create and how much it will save. Because, you know, in some respects, World War II, you know, that investment in winning World War II also paid dividends in having this incredible industrial capacity. Right now, America is losing ground to China on the critical industrial capacity for manufacturing the future that is somewhat inevitable, which is a huge amount of solar cells, huge amount of wind, huge amount of battery. I think Sam might remember the statistic, but about 90% of the world's battery capacity is now in China.
Yeah, both current and planned.
Current and planned. 90% of the solar capacity, roughly. Huge, half of the wind in terms of manufacturing capacity of these things. So I think it's a compel for the US if they wish to, you know, have another boom like that post-war boom. It is critical to engage now in manufacturing the things that will win this war. Where those things are, batteries, solar panels, electric vehicles, heat pumps, windmills, wind turbines, I should say. I still think of them as quaint windmills.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the other portion of that are the massive number of jobs that are created by installing those devices, the solar panels on people's roofs, the water heaters in people's utility rooms, HVAC systems in basements, those jobs that must take place in the US and can't be offshored. So it's an incredible opportunity for investment in American economic activity.
Xu Guang, the it's interesting because I do this work, the regulatory work in the US, but I also and the analysis, but I also do a little bit of it in Europe and in Australia. And what's interesting is Australia is the first country where all of these economics are actually provably going to save the country a huge amount of money, because for structural reasons, so Australia is about the same size as the US and it's got a lower population, so proportionally the cost of the distribution networks is higher, so the electricity grid doesn't serve as many people, so electricity is a little bit more expensive. The natural gas grid, pipeline grid, doesn't connect to as many people, so it's a little bit, it's about 50% more expensive than American natural gas. The same with petrol and gasoline. Because of that, and because of the fact that Australians have rooftop solar installing at 5 or 6 cents a kilowatt hour, and just to put that number in perspective, the average delivered cost of electricity in the US is closer to 14 cents. So rooftop solar in Australia is one third the cost of grid electricity here. But because of that, you can now model out that by about 2023, the average Australian household will be net zero if they went for a package that looks like solar on the roof, batteries on the side of the house, heat pumps for heating, two electric vehicles, and electric kitchen. By 2030, they'll be saving $5,000 to $6,000 a year. We did the same analysis in the US. It happens in about 2024 here, the crossover point. And by 2030, it looks like it's saving $2,500 or $3,000 a year per household in the US. So that is what there is to win. And I think it's underappreciated again. If you fight this war against climate at the scale that you fought World War II, we have to not just double, but we need to double, then double again, then double one more time. Three doublings, the amount of, three to four doublings, actually, the amount of batteries we make, the amount of solar we make, the amount of wind. And we know from industrial learning curves that every time you double the manufacturing capacity of these things, you'll lower the cost about 20%. So the cost of the future, you know, I think this is the challenge that we are having in a policy sense right now, is it's very difficult to make the politicians and the industry understand that we will make this future cheaper and better by virtue of doing it at enormous scale. But you've got to convince them that that's going to be true when their experience in 2021 is not quite. The electric car is still a little bit more expensive. The heat pump is still a little bit more difficult to install and a little bit more expensive. So we need to build, I think that the narrative challenge we're having in Washington and in Canberra and in Glasgow is we have to sell this vision of the future that will come true by virtue of doing it. And that's very difficult for politicians who have to make policy and respond to electorate in the present day.
Mm-hmm. So I also like another chapter you wrote about energy saved. And if you electrify,
you yes.
save half energy. You should tell us about that.
Yeah, so that's the amazing thing. And we touched on it earlier, but again, you know, so the US uses about 100 quads of quadrillion British thermal units, which is still an absurd unit for energy, but you can just sort of think of it as percentage. So we use 100 quads.
It's nice there's 100.
It is nice that there's 100 of them, so you can think of them as percentages. Makes the math easy. But the... So 8% of that goes away just by virtue of not having to make and move the fossil fuels. And then another 20% of that disappears when you eliminate the thermoelectric losses on the grid. And another 10 or 15% is eliminated when you electrify the majority of road transportation. And another 10% is eliminated when you use heat pumps for low temperature heat. Low temperature heat meaning, you know, anything roughly under boiling, so hot showers and warm houses, and they're the principal big gains from electrification, and they get you, you know, that gets you to about 40, you know, you would be running the US economy with 42% of the energy that it is today. That's a little counterintuitive to a lot of people, and it's a little offensive to some people who are environmentalists, so that because what you're kind of saying is Americans can continue to have their giant homes. They can continue to have their giant cars. They don't really need to change their lifestyles. They just need to electrify it all. And then that actually, even though I believe that is true, it does open up some schisms with the traditional environmentalist movement that want to believe, no, we must suffer. We must be cold. You must have smaller homes. You must have slower, smaller cars.
Yeah, and so most people talk about the change in renewable energy destroy jobs. You prove the otherwise. In this figure, you showed job actually good pay job increases.
Yeah, so
we should talk about all politicians want to create the jobs.
Sam and I had this experience, Shuguang, when we started Rewiring America. The first few times we would meet with politicians, their first question after they said, well, that's a nice fairy tale you tell us about electrification, and I like the story about how the costs will drop, but tell me about jobs. And it was always about jobs. And actually, Sam and I responded to that by writing a paper and doing all of the analysis that you see there on job creation, which was an interesting exercise. We had to meet an economist, and we met this lovely economist called Skip Leitner, who's sort of a guru of how you do these job growth estimates. And he walked us through the economist methodology. It was a little dissatisfying as sort of an MIT science nerd to sort of see how the economics methods work. But nevertheless, it's the established method. And if you actually really did commit the American economy to do this very quickly, like in two decades, it would create 25 million new jobs in the short term over the existing energy jobs. And over the long term, that will taper off a little, but it would be 8 million more jobs. And I think some of the anecdotes in that are interesting. So in the way we calculate jobs in energy today is done by the US Census Bureau. And they calculate about 1.9 million jobs in energy, in the existing energy industry, direct jobs. But that includes less than 50,000 people doing coal mining, but it also includes 900,000 people that work in gas stations. But it's curious to think about the jobs of people working in gas stations. Is that an energy job, or is that selling tobacco and corn syrup? job. Whereas in the electrification is going to require building and maintaining the industrial wind turbines, the industrial solar, building and maintaining a grid that will need to deliver 3 or 4 times as much electricity. And all of those create a lot of jobs, but the enormous job growth is actually on the demand side. That's where we use all of that electricity. So it's in manufacturing the cars, installing, you know, 250 million vehicle charging things, some in basements, some in garages, some in public car parks. It'll be installing solar on 100 million roofs. It'll be, you know, I think another fun job we did this year was calculating the number of machines that are in the US economy that burn fossil fuels still. And there's, you know, 280 million vehicles, there's 121 million homes with 90 million natural gas water heaters and 60 million natural gas and fuel oil space heaters. There's 20 million natural gas clothes dryers still there. There's 80 odd million natural gas cooking things. But when you think about all of those, they all add up to about 500 or 600 million machines. And then to then switch them all to electricity, you'll also need to add all of the solar. You'll also need to add a new load center. That's the electrical circuit that connects your home to the grid and divides up to all the circuits inside the house. You'll also need to add batteries. It adds up to like a billion machines. And so if you think of, you know, manufacturing, deploying, installing with contractors, a billion machines across the US economy, and you do it on the time scale required for climate, it's one machine a second every second for the next 20 years. That's a lot of jobs and a lot of, you know, traditionally well-paying, respect in the community, construction and, you know, construction installation jobs.
Definitely. It's, you know, it's important to keep in mind too that the majority of these machines are already slated to be replaced. They have a natural life cycle. They're going to need replacement. And the critical thing is just making sure that at that juncture, the people who make that decision, whether it's a homeowner or, you know, someone else, have the resources they need to say, no, I'm not going to install another piece of fossil equipment. I'm going to make the switch to electric. And that can be a hard thing when you don't have a hot shower and you need, you know, the heat pump water heater is going to take a little bit longer to get in. It can be a difficult thing, one that requires planning ahead. But doing that planning is, as individuals, one of the most impactful things that we can do to help this transition.
And the hotels use a lot of washing machine and a dryer and the 24/7. If it can convince hotel chains and to change all the dryers, the washing machines into electrical system, and that of big savings almost very fast. And also people like to get something cheap. And then if you sell this electric system with a subsidy, like a subsidy for the cars, and sell them for $100 a piece, and people will replace from left to right. Just like a Black Friday after Thanksgiving, people all could buy cheap stuff.
You've just reminded me of two interesting things, Shuguang. One of them you will love. The biggest efficiency gain in the American energy economy in the last 20 years was the biological enzyme that replaced the enzymes in detergents that enabled us to use cold water for washing dishes and washing clothes instead of hot water. And it was profoundly influential, your expertise in that. And that obviously the hotel example reminded me of that. The subsidy thing that you brought up is dear to us right now, because I think if we sort of think about those billion machines, so the wealthy households will all be able to afford to replace those. Every household is going to have to buy a new water heater in the next 20 years anyway, and probably by the time they get there, the easy economic choice will be the heat pump. But what about the lowest 20 or 40% of homes in terms of income? They're all already energy stressed, meaning struggling to pay their energy bills. It's as much as 10% or more of their monthly expenditures. But we need to, you know, so you could You can't solve climate change if you only half solve it to the half of people who can afford it. Right. And so in writing policy, which Sam and I had a hand in this year, we were very adamant to try and figure out what are mechanisms that will work for low income households, where we already know some interesting statistics, like, you know, 40% of water heaters and air conditioning units are bought under a situation of duress. Probably your wife or your partner is pregnant. It's the middle of winter or the middle of summer. You need a hot water heater tomorrow or an air conditioner tomorrow. But those homes don't have $400 in cash. So they have to buy these things on credit. They have to buy the cheapest one in the store, which is the least efficient and almost always fossil fuels. So we actually worked on creating subsidies and rebates so that you got about every purchasing decision that's going to be made in the next 20 years, you want to make it buy the right machine. And I think, and it won't be popular in some corners of politics, but we're now in such an emergency with climate, we need to figure out how to rebate those at every point of purchase.
Yeah, so all of these things are generally higher upfront costs, but lower ongoing costs, the electric alternatives compared to fossil fuels. And so in putting together this package of incentives, it's important to try to tailor them to unlock that long-term potential savings in the context that's appropriate for the household. So as Saul said, direct point of sale rebates to low and moderate income households, tax credits for slightly wealthier households that have enough tax liability, and short-term cash to handle the upfront costs until the tax year is over. And then kind of universally access to low-cost financing that lets you directly play that upfront cost against long-term savings, so that you can make kind of the right electrification decisions, not the ones you're forced into.
Mm-hmm. So I was most intrigued to see you have one chapter about the state, how many the states and that large states generate little renewable energy, has the most land. Even the change in attitude, then we'll become a wealthy state. And we can generate the largest solar energy, wind energy, and selling to other states who demands a lot, like Massachusetts and New York and California and so on.
So the origin of that is the day after the Trump won the election in 2016, I was interested in how fossil fuel production by state matched politics. And it turned out, if you took the electoral map from 2016, I think it was 88% of coal was mined in states that voted Republican, 87% of natural gas, and 86% of oil. It turns out that was still true in 2020, even with Biden winning. And at first, so you can actually kind of see why Republican Democrat politics around energy goes the way it goes, because it's literally in the financial interest of those states to be, you know, self-serving, self-interested, because they generate a lot of revenue from fossil fuels. But then it gets a little bit more interesting, because if you then map the land area, it's about the same. And it turns out that, turns out the reason that the red states have all of the fossil fuels is because the red states have all of the land. And what do you need if you're going to make it a lot of renewables to solve climate? You're going to need a lot of land. And obviously Texas is already doing this somewhat. And there's the wind revolution in Texas, huge amounts of wind power. It's the fastest growing wind energy market in the world. And they're learning that experience. I actually think this is a cause for some hope and some optimism. As the profitability of solar and wind and renewables and electrification happens in these red states, I think we really are going to see the political bit flip. And just to give you a pretty radical preview of that, Fox News is owned by Rupert Murdoch, and Fox in America has terrible energy climate history in terms of sort of denying and gaslighting. But I actually presided over a media campaign in Australia only a month ago, where Fox Murdoch Media in Australia did a complete about face They pretended that they've always believed in the climate science and that climate change is real and that the things we need to do to save the climate will benefit the Australian economy. And they ran a 16-page special section on climate with a lot of the numbers on the economics that I had calculated for Australia. And they ran it in every newspaper in every state and in every capital city in Australia because they see the politics is flipping in Australia, and that's because the economics is flipping in Australia in favor of the electrification and renewables. So I believe that Fox was just using Australia as a test market for that messaging, and I believe we will see that in the US, I imagine, leading into the 2024 elections. So watch that forecast now.
And I truly believe this real estate or this economic advantage into Maine. Maine is not wealthy, and I was just there. But if Maine produce a lot of electricity through the wind and the solar and so on, export to Massachusetts, Maine become rich state.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, Vermont has a lot of solar panels, but not Maine. They're on the same kind of altitude. But why? Why is some state, Vermont, is more progressive? They have a lot of solar panels. I don't connect Vermont as a solar panel production state, but every place it goes, solar panel on the house, on the land, and so on. By Maine, very little. So it's a very interesting phenomenon here. But then can also export to Massachusetts, to Connecticut, it's all the neighboring state, can make a lot of money out of this.
Vermont got the incentives right.
Yeah, it's
they had the political will to do it.
They need the investment for that.
Maine is one of the only states in America where you'll literally go to a diner and see two little old ladies talking about foreign policy because it affects oil prices and because it's a state that still has a lot of oil heating, and heating oil is an incredibly expensive way to heat your home. Like it's very tangible, and you know, US foreign and energy policy is tangible in Maine because of the winter heating requirements. Mm. That can now be serviced with modern heat pumps, solar, renewables, wind, and it would be, Sam did a study this year on the economics of it, and it does brilliantly in economically.
Absolutely. So the heat pump, the thing we call a heat pump, shares a name with a 10-year-old technology that didn't work that well and has kind of a bad rap. Heat pumps today, due to improvements in variable speed compressors and new refrigerants and refrigerant injection, and they're just better machines, and their coefficient of performance, how much heat they output for how much electricity you input, has gone through the roof, even in cold places like Maine. And they're being installed like gangbusters in Maine. Efficiency Maine is the local group that helps people realize incentives for installing them. So while Maine might be lagging Vermont on solar, Maine's crushing it on heat pumps.
I actually think there's an interesting point there. As we think about, you know, the whole world has to go on this transition, and nobody is doing it right. And I think we need to be running thousands of experiments at state levels to figure out what the right sets of solutions are for different geographies. But you could sort of broadly say, you know, if you could invent a perfect country right now that is doing the best on climate change, it would have Australian rooftop solar policy, which has eliminated the soft costs and got it to about $1 a watt installed, 5 or 6 cents a kilowatt hour. It would be Norwegian electric vehicle policy. So by 2025, they will be selling 100% electric vehicles. And it's probably South Korean or Japanese heat pump policy, although it might be Maine heat pump policy. And if you could get all of those things happening in the one geographic place, that is roughly the recipe we need to move very quickly at scale and find the solution. I think actually in the US, all of the most interesting things are happening in state energy offices and state programs. if you look at NYSERDA in New York or California Energy Commission in California, some very interesting programs are happening there. And what we need is for those programs to succeed and then be scaled up and become national programs.
And so, we need to take the best of everywhere, and we need to be comfortable sharing it with each other, installing transmission. So like I just talked up Maine, but Maine did just vote down a large transmission line between a big hydro facility. And so we need to not do things like that.
Yeah. So I really like your comparison World War Zero with World War II. And you have ammunition, the ships with bullets and so on, Liberty ships with the solar farms, bullets, batteries, and so on. This comparison is so understandable. So maybe you can elaborate about your compare World War II after US win the war. And you mentioned earlier, but how US invested so much money, now it's time to do it. Otherwise, 50 years later, we don't have United States as well as we know it.
Unfortunately, I don't think we see, to your point, like, yeah, Cambridge will be underwater, New York will be underwater by the end of the century. We don't feel that as a fear the same way we didn't feel that, you know, America was reluctant to join World War II. Right, 1938. We had no army, didn't want to be part of it. Churchill called Roosevelt after he lost at Dunkirk and said, "Beware, Hitler's coming, and it's going to be a war that's won with machines." Because that was the first time, you know, the tanks and the airplanes were critical in Germany taking France, and Churchill was scared, and then he called Roosevelt to make Roosevelt scared. Because he said, look, if they come and capture the British Navy, then they're going to come after you. And it took Roosevelt a couple of years to build consensus and support that it really was a war that they had to engage in and had to win. And then when he did, he actually hired a guy from Detroit, a manufacturing guy, to head up the wartime production board. And say, you know, get all of the automakers involved. Let's figure out how to make exactly. And then they listed what they had to call critical munitions, bullets, airplanes, Liberty ships. In before the war, America had only 1,100 aircraft in 1939. And most of those were single seat training aircraft. By the end of the war, they were producing something like 50,000 Liberty bombers a month. So we need that type of scale up. The incentive used in the war was really interesting. They used cost plus 7%. So they actually called it patriotism plus 7%. The US government basically said, if your company can make any of these critical things, we will cover your costs and allow you to take a 7% profit. That would be great if we could, you know, that's the dream policy that Sam and I have failed to get rid of.
Yeah, people always hungry for profit and industry. Yeah. And as it saw the other sense, you put it so detailed, is how personal, individual, each one of us can help to reduce energy in your chapter 18 or something, chapter 18. You let so detail individually how we can help to do this. And we should practice, follow your advice. Yeah, we can tell more about how we came up with the list. That's a fantastic list. Yeah.
I think there could be a lot more, but I you know, this was a response, like I'm sure most people here have watched Al Gore's movie, The Inconvenient Truth, and we've seen a lot of these books in these movie about climate change, and everyone's natural question after you've read something like this or watched something like this is, well, what do I do? I've always been dissatisfied because I think after Al Gore's movie, it was like, well, you know, buy a stainless steel water bottle and recycle your coffee cups, and we just need much more concrete action than that. And so I really sort of went, you know, if you're a lawyer, you need to do this. If you're an engineer, do this. If you're a farmer, do this. Because I really wanted to make it super concrete. what people can do, because I actually do, I think people want to succeed. I don't think the majority of humans wish to be extinguished by our own stupidity. And so I think giving people ideas for how they can engage is really important. I also think it's really important to understand, this isn't your question, but it's something that I find really interesting. I think we're in danger of trying to lay too much blame on the fossil fuel companies and not recognize that we are the customers. And what's really representative of this to me is this, this divestment movement, which says we should divest from the 100 worst fossil fuel companies. And they list only companies that either make coal, make natural gas, or make oil. What's really interesting to me is they don't say divest from Toyota or divest from Ford, even though 2% of the world's emissions come out of a machine that Toyota made and another 2% come out of the ass of a machine that Ford made. But it's like too close to us as consumers to mention that it's our cars are the problem, right? So we can love our car, but we don't love the stuff we put in it. And I sort of found that hypocrisy a little weird. And so I actually think another way of framing this is, well, how much of the solution can we be? And again, if you redraw the way that we do these energy maps and you redraw it around the household instead of redrawing it by these abstract sectors, because when people talk, very serious people talk about energy and they talk about the industrial sector and the commercial sector and the residential sector and all these sectors that don't really mean anything. But what if you talk about how our emissions happen from things that we decide about at our kitchen table? What cars do we drive? What heat do we use? Where do we source our electricity from? What do we cook with in our kitchen? And how do we do our laundry, right? It's determined 40%+ of our emissions. If you commercial sector, so our small businesses and buildings, it's another 20%. So we actually have control over a huge proportion of our emissions in these daily decisions. And actually, you didn't mention it, but it was one of my favorite ideas in the book, is that we need to stop, again, thinking, you know, the traditional environmentalist movement says, you know, recycle your, don't use plastic straws, recycle this and that. And you sort of end up incapacitated in the daily decision-making of trying to save the planet. Whereas I think we should think about more of these five or six deep decisions that you make once every 10 years as the infrastructure of your life. So if you make a good decision in that once every 10 years and choose the right electric vehicle, you choose the right heat pump water heater for the, you know, you can basically just live your life and you're doing the right thing. And it's a much easier set of decisions. It's a set of five or six things, not a million.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
hey, Rob, gentlemen, I'm sorry to interrupt. We can keep going on and on, but I want to make some time for some, we've got some great questions coming in from the audience, and I just wanted to make some time for that. So sorry to interrupt, but if it's okay, I'll get through some of those. This has been really fascinating, so thank you all for your time.
Please.
This first question comes from Arthur, who says, electrifying everything with modern technologies will require a lot of conductive materials like copper or lithium for batteries. Are there enough proven reserves in the US and the world to do that?
There are enough proven reserves of everything except maybe cobalt. So there is enough copper, there is enough lithium. Cobalt, we might scrape it in, but not every battery will require cobalt. I think there's an interesting, I get this question a lot, and it makes me want to say the following. So the average American lifestyle today uses 6,000 kilograms of fossil fuels every year. So 6 tons, and then we burn it and it goes into the atmosphere and it becomes 25 tons of carbon dioxide. 15 or so. If you think about, the average American life is 10,000 watts, you get this discount because you electrify everything, so it uses less energy. So let's call it around 5,000 watts of constant energy that you need to supply that at American. If you then just do a very simple thought exercise, I'll provide half of that energy with wind power, half of that energy with solar power, and I'll store half of that energy in batteries, that to make all of that, then you need the batteries because the wind and the sun doesn't blow all the time. It turns out you'd only need about 50 kilograms, a little less than 50 kilograms of wind turbines, 50 kilograms of solar and 50 kilograms of batteries for each person every year. So that's 150 kilograms. But actually, because the majority of all of those machines are metals that are and glasses that are highly recyclable, we'll probably recycle 80 or 90% of it. And so you'll only need to be mining, you know, 5 to 10 kilograms of each of these things each year for everyone. If you think about the environmental foot of moving 6 tons across the landscape a year for every in the US versus 10 or 15 kilograms of stuff every year, I actually think that there's a huge environmental win. It won't be perfect. We still will have to dig up a few mountainsides for some lithium salts and some of these rare earths, but it's going to be enormously better than the existing status quo. Much lighter environmental footprint.
Yeah, less mass, more opportunities for recycling. And especially in the context of batteries, watching the recycling and reuse industries ramp up as more and more EVs, mostly Nissan Leafs, are reaching end of life, and there's a growing supply of batteries that aren't good enough for use in a mobile application like an electric car, but they are good enough for stationary storage, and there's tons of valuable materials in there. If you just try to go buy those cells, they're expensive. There's a market here. Like, it's happening. So, plus a million to what Saul said. Less mass, more recycling.
And there's some alternative called graphene. Graphene is made carbon. Carbon is oil and coal. If you think and natural gas, so you can convert the coal, oil, and natural gas into graphene. You have infinite amount of the material, carbon-based material for storing electricity. The research is ongoing, but very slow. European put $1 billion into that research. US, on the last 4 years, essentially little research on graphene for energy storage. Imagine you don't need all the rare earth metals, just convert coal and oil into graphene for storage energy. Lightweight, that may even have an airplane carry graphene battery flying rather than oil. Imagine that, but need the research first.
Yeah. Thank you guys for that great answer. We've got our next question is a regional question. So Massachusetts seems to be in the process of reevaluating how MassSave, which is its energy efficiency program, what can we do at the state level to get to the proper rebates and incentives in place?
I'll answer this first. Although Sam looks desperate, you should go first, Sam.
Oh, I was just going to say, take all the federal policies that are either passing at diminished levels or failing to pass and implement state versions of them.
Okay.
That's what I suggest.
Yeah, so what does that really mean? If you could do a perfect state, you would say run a certification and training program to train solar installers to also be able to do the permitting and inspection so that you make the solar generated electricity the cheapest. That would be a fabulous thing. Eliminate subsidies that you have for fossil fuels in your state. There's still a whole bunch of subsidies just to make the playing field more level. And then while the market is developing, provide subsidies or rebates for electric vehicles to bring their costs down to parity with internal combustion engines. So today you'd probably have to give a $10,000 rebate, you know, it's a $7,500 is the federal rebate for electric vehicles. That gets it roughly to parity. We know that by 2025 or 2026, electric vehicles will be cheaper in the showroom, but we just need to rebate them until that market is fully transformed. We need to provide rebates around induction cooktops, rebates around heat pump water heaters and heat pump space heaters. One of the clever pieces of policy that is sort of trying to work through the federal government is to make sure that if you do any one of these upgrades to your home, that it triggers an upgrade to the main panel. That's the circuit on the side of the house. That's going to be the limit for many homes going on this electrification journey. They were designed really only to supply your appliances and your lights, but now we're going to put your cars and your heating systems on them. They need to have higher capacity. So state programs that make the main panel upgrade or subsidized in some way so that the next three things that that house does are much, much easier and cheaper to do because the circuitry has been upgraded with the capacity to take it. So that was getting very specific, and that sounded like I was stump speeching a state politician on what they should do.
I'll add one more political hack here, which is to make sure that any kind of incentives that are being structured are structured around performance standards for the appliance, not around technologies. This is something where the best fossil fuel gas furnace you could put in your basement is like 98% efficient or something. An electric heat pump that provides the same service will be 300% efficient due to the magic of thermodynamics because it's pumping heat, not generating it. Defining a performance standard at, above 100% means that heat pumps qualify and fossil fuels don't. And you never had to explicitly outlaw fossil fuels. And that can be very, very politically expedient. And so always making incentives structured on the basis of performance, technically driven performance standards is a really, really strong thing to push for.
Great. Our next question we have is, if we achieve full electrification and make electricity cheaper, how do we prevent people from using excessive amounts of this cheap resource? Example, the LED is an efficient source of light, so now we put them literally on everything. From an engineering perspective, this is clearly the right way to go, but reducing the cost will increase its usage unless policies are put in place to prevent that from happening.
I want to jump on this question.
Yeah, sure. And then the end is, but managing human behavior is difficult, as you point out in your book.
Start over.
Saul. You froze just a little bit.
This is known as Jevons paradox, which is that you make things cheaper and then people use more of it. And there will be some of that. But I think that might be okay. The environmentalist movement, driven by this efficiency idea, which was the 1970s mindset, has always struggled with an idea that things can be abundant. And I think a huge number of people would prefer abundance. I actually think that a little bit of growth, so I don't believe, even though I think you could run the whole US economy electrically on 40%, I think we'll probably use 50 or 60 because it will grow. I like the crazy idea, and it also addresses the culture wars, because there's a lot of culture wars about, if I electrify my truck, then you're going to steal my weekend. If you electrify my boat, it won't be as fast, etc. I think we've just got to say, well, that's not true. Jet skis are a horrible, noisy, maybe the worst possible use of fossil fuels ever. You burn 14 gallons of gasoline in an hour, making noise that terrifies beachgoers. But having said that, I'm going to say that maybe the future will be awesome if we have electric jet skis in them, because an electric jet ski will need 100 kilowatt hour battery, and you only use your jet ski about three times a year. So for 353 days of the year, that can be an enormously valuable grid asset that helps balance the grid. You can use it as the storage for, if there's ever an outage. The next outage in Texas will be solved by all the electric jet skis that plug into the grid and feed power back into the grid. So there's actually a virtue to having an abundance and thinking not of getting just barely to 100% renewable, but getting to 120 or 125% renewable. Once you have that excess, that buffer, that's actually also where we will get more security, energy security, more reliability. And curiously, oversupply is probably the cheapest way to solve a lot of our seasonal and our storage problems. So industrial wind and solar is installing at 3 or 4 cents a kilowatt hour. Sam and I also did the crude math on this. If you, instead of designing the system to average out through the whole year just to 100%, imagine you design the energy system for the worst day of the year in the middle of winter when everyone's heating, and that is, turns out that's about 25% below the rest of the year. So if you had an oversupply of wind and solar of 25%, you're designing for the worst case, not for the best case. It means you'll have a lot of cheap electricity in summer. But what it does mean is the incremental cost of adding that 25% capacity is under 1 cent per kilowatt hour. It's way cheaper than any of the storage mechanisms we have. So I think there is a danger that we could have, you know, I think you can also say it's true. We could solve climate change and still choke the oceans with plastics. So we should be cautious with this abundance idea, lest it get away in those ways. However, I do think a little more of the abundant mindset actually helps solve a lot of people's fears and address a lot of the culture wars around the transition.
That's a really great answer. Go ahead, Sam.
Concepts of scarcity are weaponized by the fossil fuel industry to make people afraid of the transition. Range anxiety sort of isn't, with a modern electric car, kind of isn't a thing anymore. The batteries are large enough and good enough that you don't really experience it. Things like, you know, the heat pump not being able to supply enough warmth in the winter, modern heat pumps, it's really less of a thing.
I'll give you a couple of great examples from my own life. I just built a new house in San Francisco and we designed the solar system for the winter. It means we were producing so much energy off our own rooftop for the rest of the year that we're going to heat for 8 months of the year will be free for a swimming pool. I've nearly won this argument with my wife, and I'm hoping that the more times I say it publicly, I make it true. I actually like vintage cars, which is a weird thing to admit as an environmentalist, and I own a 1961 Lincoln Continental, which is a beautiful, it was actually one of the first presidential limousines. And it got about 9 miles per gallon. It's horrific. But when I electrify that, and I actually just bought the Ford electric crate motor, so I will put it in, that battery and that car is going to be about a quarter of the price of a Tesla Powerwall. So I'm going to get all of the battery backup I ever need, and I'm going to get a free vintage car to drive around as a byproduct. Again, I think if we just switch to the mindset of we might be able to solve a lot of these things, it might get better. We're going to get to a better place than fighting constantly from a position of scarcity.
That's a really great answer. Thanks, Saul. Well, I want to be mindful of the time. We're a little bit over. We really appreciate you all submitting questions. I've collected the questions that we weren't able to answer, and we'll be sharing them with Saul and our other guests to answer at a later time. That will go up once this video is edited and posted very soon. So we appreciate you submitting your questions. Saul, Sam, Shugong, we can't thank you guys enough. You're fighting the good fight and we so appreciate it. We've posted in the chat more ways to learn about Electrify. Visit the MIT Press website and support independent bookstores or find an audio or ebook version. And also the MIT Press Live virtual event series will have another event next month. We hope you'll stay tuned. But yeah, thank you all so much.
Can I tack on there?
Yeah.
Go to rewiringamerica.org and take the pledge to electrify your life.
Definitely.
Nice plug.